talk about koinonia. Some of you may know what that is, some of you may not know what it is. It's a nice Greek word. I love Greek words, because you can make them up, can't you? And just say whatever you want to say about them. But koinonia simply means fellowship in its simplest way. But of course, like most Greek words, it's a bit complicated as well. And we're going to unpack some of that. And the reason why I took the picture last night is because I want us to think about our fellowship. And more importantly, actually, your fellowship. Because when I say I was, yes, I'm here, and we're here, and Leslie's here, we're here together. But actually, I want to think about your fellowship and what that means for you at St. Anne's. We're going to watch a DVD first. It is multimedia, this, you'd be happy to know. It's not just me talking for hours on end. Yeah, can we go for that? And you have to twiddle your thingy.
Years I went to church because you're supposed to. But there were things about it that just didn't seem right. You know what I'm talking about? It's like a lot of times I found myself looking around thinking, is this what God had in mind? And then I came across this passage in the Bible that helped me start to see things in a new way. It tells the story of Jesus having a meal with some of the religious leaders of his day. And they have all these complicated hand-washing rituals that they go through before they eat. And Jesus ignores their rules. And one of them notices this and points this out. And Jesus says, you religious leaders, it's like you clean the outside of the cup, but the inside is filled with greed and evil. I mean, you give away 10% of your income, but you don't really care about making the world a better place. Then Jesus says to them, he says, everything for you is about being seen in public as important people. I mean, you love to be looked up to. You love to be respected. You love the best seats where everyone can see you. And Jesus says, everything for you is about appearance, how things look to other people. And then he says to them, you're like unmarked graves, which people walk over without knowing it. I mean, Jesus essentially tells the religious leaders of his day, you're spiritually dead, and you don't even realize it. Now, one of them who was sitting there, he'd be like what we'd call a preacher, and he realizes what's going on here. I mean, Jesus is like slamming them. And he says, you know, Jesus, when you say stuff like this, you insult us. And Jesus says, you, teachers like you, you tell people to do all this stuff, but you don't help them do any of it. I mean, all you end up doing is just heaping on the guilt. I mean, people end up feeling terrible about themselves. And then later he says to these same leaders, he says, you travel over land and sea to win a single convert. And when they become one, you make them twice the sons of hell that you are. Jesus calls the leading religious authorities of his day sons of hell. And what disturbs him the most is that they go around making converts who they pressure to become just like them. I mean, he goes on to tell them, you've abused your positions of religious authority, and you're actually getting in the way of people who are honestly searching for God. Sons of hell. There are many moments like these in the teachings of Jesus. I mean, to people who are wrestling with the deepest questions of life, Jesus has like infinite patience and understanding. But to people who claim to know and speak for God, but have like hard, cold hearts, when he is relentless, when Jesus gets angry. Okay, let's say this. Let's say I bring my wife home some flowers. I mean, these are some beautiful flowers. Like, I try to get the colors just right, and you know the drill. And I bring them in the house, and I give them to her, and she's, like, blown away. And she takes out a vase, and she smiles, and she just says, "This means so much that you were thinking of me. I'm so surprised." And what if I say, "Well, I'm your husband. It's my duty." It just doesn't work for you, does it? Or what if I said to her, "Well, you know, there was a sale, and like I wasn't really thinking of you, but it wasn't really a hassle. They were cheap, and I figured that's not a big deal." Or what if I just said to her, "Like, well, I figured you needed them." Does she even want the flowers anymore? No. Why? Because she wants my heart, and if she doesn't have my heart, my words and my actions don't mean a thing. Is this how God feels? One of the central prayers of Jesus' life was called the Shema. Part of it goes like this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. I mean, we can go to Mass or services or prayers every day. I mean, we can sing all the right songs and we can recite all the right prayers. But if it's just going through the motions, I mean, what's the point? God says in the book of Isaiah, these people, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Sometimes we have to stop and ask, why do we do what we do? To keep the family happy? So that I don't feel guilty? Making an appearance at the right place at the right time, wearing the right clothes so that I can be seen by the right people. The scriptures remind us that God doesn't want the empty ritual. God wants our hearts. So that I can get God off my back? I mean, God gets what God wants so that I can do what I want with the rest. When God has my heart, and I realize that everything I have, I've been given. There's even a letter in the Bible called Corinthians in which God commands people not to give out of compulsion or guilt or reluctance. The letter even goes on to say, you should only give what you decided in your heart to give. Because God loves it when you give because you want to. If I'm giving because I think that I'm supposed to, or because God needs it, or so that I don't feel guilty, I should keep it. God doesn't want it. There's even another passage in the Bible where God is speaking to some extremely religious people. They've been coming to his temple and going through all the right ceremonies, and yet they've been neglecting the needs of those around them. And God speaks to them and says, you know, your sacrifices and your offerings, what is this to me? You know, I don't take any pleasure in this. God hates it. He can't stand it. when we put on a religious show and then we ignore the poor and the broken, the marginalized and the oppressed. God even calls their gatherings evil. God says they become like a burden to it, that his soul hates them. I mean, God even says, I am weary of them. It's almost like God says, I don't want those flowers. God wants our hearts, because when God has our hearts, we'll start to care about the things that God cares about. We'll start to care about the people that God cares about. And God says, seek justice, encourage the oppressed, defend the cause of the fatherless, plead the case of the widow. And when you realize that you can do something about the suffering in the world, when you realize that there's work to be done and you can do it, then your heart is starting to beat like God's. I mean, is church a building? Like an hour, once a week? Church is people. People whose hearts are beating more and more like God's. I mean, maybe you're turned off to judgmental attitudes and narrow minds and meaningless rules. I mean, so am I. And so is God. I mean, God doesn't want anything to do with that either. Let's be honest. A lot of people confuse religion with God and walk away from them both. The point isn't Christianity. The point is being a Christian. I mean, it's being a follower of Jesus. It's being connected with everything that's true and good and right. Everything that goes on around us that reminds us that there is so much more going on around us than we realize. Could anything be more beautiful?
Some years ago, visiting a church for the first time, and Leslie and I were visiting a church that was our two children, and it was quite an experience. We went in through the entrance, and there was nobody there to welcome us. Nobody. The people were milling around, sort of in the distance, and there was nobody there. There were some books by the side, and we thought, well, maybe these are the books, and maybe that one, and there you go. And we walked into the church, into the worship area. We got a seat somewhere in the middle, and again nobody was coming saying hello to us. There was nobody there to welcome us, and we were obviously a new family. We were obviously there for the first time, and yes, people were pointing at us. And,
who's there? Who are they? I don't know. He's handsome, though, isn't he?
Sure, I'm sure that's what I heard. There was nothing, and there was nobody coming saying hello, and you're new here, and where have you come from, and are you visiting us today, and none of that. And the service came, and it started, and we went through the motions, as was on the DVD. The service finished, and there was no staying behind at the end. There was no tea or coffee. A few people did say hello, but ultimately we went out, and that was it. Oh, we put our books back as well. And it was really an eye-opener. for both of us, Leslie and me, because the problem was, I was going to become the vicar of that church a few months later. And we'd gone incognito, just to see what it was like. And it was really a shock to us, because we thought, gosh, you know, we were totally new. There was nobody else in that church that was new. Everybody knew we were different because they hadn't seen us before. And there was no welcome. And it was a real reality check for us as we were preparing then to become vicars of that church, what that church was really like. And I always remember that. And every time I go to a new church now, but one of my things I will do always is make sure that our priority is to welcome people into church. The most important people in any church are the welcomers, because they're the first faces anybody sees. And if that's your face and you're the one to say, good morning, welcome to St. Anne's, lovely that you're with us today, and just to have that conversation and make people feel welcome, then people are more likely to come back, because they know that you value them, that you love them and that you care for them, even if it's just for that one service at that one time, that you are welcome. And it taught Leslie and I a lesson which I've never forgot. And as I say, always now, in any church I go to, I will go to, make sure we welcome people into church. Some people, I imagine most people, if asked what church is like, will probably say something like this. That's the nod. No, go back. Yeah, you skipped one. It's okay, I'm not complaining. That's another video. Yes, this if you go down to the... This should be another one. This should be two. Try it.
Take.
Church, that's what church is like. And I remember a friend of mine, I didn't grow up in church. I wasn't in a church family. I only went to church because I met a girl and fancied her, and she went to church, so that's what I had to do. And a friend of mine, he said he grew up in the church, and for him, he said prayers were just like that. He's like, amen, because that's all he could hear. And then he was absolutely amazed when he found out that God's name was Harold. And there was a Harold in the church, you see. But for a lot of people, church has this stereotype, and it's never changed. And sometimes, sadly, sometimes, maybe like the church I went into all those years ago, it fulfills that stereotype as well. And sometimes people are less likely to want to be part of that or to go to that. So I want us to think just for a moment about what is church. See, that's seamless, that wasn't it? Just talk to the person next to you for a moment and just ask that question of each other. What is church? Just spend a couple of minutes just chatting. Talk to yourself.
I'm going to go to the next one.
just think about those for a moment. Here's a few that I've put down. Yeah. Church. People meet on a regular basis. They go at a usual set time at a set place. Next one, please. They have a shared interest, which is celebrated.
Yeah.
And you have something that binds you together, and you celebrate that. Next one. You abide by an agreed set of rules and instructions. Ian, you keep them under your thumb, don't you? Yeah. Next one, please. Some activities outside of regular time, so it's not just what goes on in church. Next one, please. But that could be said of all those, couldn't it? Could be train enthusiasts, Ramblers Society, Darby and Joan, Book Club, Bell Ringers, Liverpool Football Association. It could be any of those things as well, couldn't it? Those things could be said of any of those institutions. So what is it that makes church different? That was close. What is it that makes church special? Because I always find one of the things that I'm always asking myself is, how are we distinctive? How are we different? We live in a society, and church is very much a part of our society, and we are part of that society. And very often, we get the margins blurred. And what makes church distinctive and unique and special? And this is where the word koinonia comes in. That's spelled in Greek, by the way. See, that's good though, isn't it? See, I've done that. That's at the background. I spent minutes on this. Koinonia. And it's quite simply, it means fellowship. There we go. Actually, it means quite a lot more than that. Like most, I said before, most Greek words, it isn't as simple or as straightforward as that. And what we might understand by fellowship has to really be then rethought when we think about what the Bible says about fellowship, and in particular what the New Testament says about fellowship when it comes to church. The word koinonia is very commonly used in the Greek world. And as I pointed out before, in all those different aspects of life, the word koinonia can be used, because it is fellowship, it is coming together, it is having a shared interest, it's all of those. But when it comes to church, when it comes to the Christian community, the Bible has a different way of looking at it. And maybe a way that we can learn from as we think about our koinonia, our fellowship, here today, here this weekend, but more importantly, there in Egbert, there in St. Anne's. I want to look at what the Bible says about koinonia. I'm going to hit the next one, please. So there are going to be some Bible passages up there. If you have a Bible, great, you can look them up, but they are going to be up here as well. I think probably the most famous verse that talks about this fellowship, this koinonia, comes in Acts, and actually it's the first mention of the word. Acts 2:42-44, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, koinonia, to the breaking of bread and prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles, and all the believers were together and had everything in common. And this passage comes right at the start of the church as we know it. It follows on from the events of Pentecost, which is early on in chapter 2 in Acts. Of course, that's when the Holy Spirit came down, and all the believers, well, the whole church could be probably fitted into this room. The whole worldwide church at that moment was just maybe a few more than we are here in number, in a room probably this size. And that's the worldwide church as it was then. Now, of course, there's over 2 billion Christians. But then there was just about 100. And they all fitted into that room, and the Holy Spirit came down upon them, tongues of flame, speaking in different languages. And it's amazing, I've been to Wigan. And they even speak the gospel in Wigan. And of course they go out into the streets and they preach this good news about Jesus who died, who rose again, who is alive today. And we're told that the impact was that some 3,000 people became believers. Can't imagine that, can you? 3,000 people became believers on that Pentecost. And then those 3,000 people, we're told, sat at the feet of the apostles each day, listening to them and learning from them. These new Christians were just starting to learn what it meant to live as church. They were learning how to live in a relationship with God and with each other. And there were no manuals, there were no books, there were no instructions, there was no robes or dog collars. It was just, here we are. How are we going to do this? How do we live together? Everything was new. And new ways of being God's people, being followers of Christ, were having to be learned. And here we see the beginning of koinonia, the beginning of fellowship. And here in the reading, we see that the believers, next one please. See that then. Okay. They devoted themselves to the fellowship. Now, the first thing I want to say about fellowship, koinonia, it isn't a passive thing. It isn't something that we just go along to or join with. We talk about, we'll have a time of fellowship after the service, and usually that means having a cup of tea and a chat, which is great. It's not fellowship in the way the Bible talks about. This is a deliberate action. You are to create fellowship. You're to create koinonia. And it was a deliberate action on the part of the believers actively seeking to build fellowship. And it was within the church. This wasn't about how we relate to people outside the church. It's how do you relate to each other? How do you care for each other? How do you have fellowship with each other in a way that allows this church to grow? Because it grew. And if it wasn't for that Pentecost, if it wasn't for these Christians, we wouldn't be here today. Because it grew and it grew and it grew. And so much of that was because of the fellowship that was being formed between these early Christians, this early church. Next one, please. So the believers had everything in common. Everything in common. And I think that's a challenge to us today. Because we live in a very materialistic world. We live in a very self-centered world. And to be able to have everything in common, and of course, as we'll see further on, to give things up, to give to each other, is quite a challenge. It's quite a challenge to us. But it would have been to some of those people then as well. They had everything in common. Now, there's two aspects of koinonia I want to look at just in this, what have we got, half an hour or so, 25 minutes. Next one, please. It's the koinonia that we have a share in, and, please, the koinonia that we give a share in. The koinonia that we have a share in, and the koinonia that we give a share in. Next slide, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. He will keep you firm to the end, so that you will be faultless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is to be trusted. The God who called you to have fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Koinonia, fellowship, is something that you have a share in. What is or should be different when we speak about belonging or being part of a church? What is it that makes us different? It's simply the fact that at the heart of church is a living relationship with God. And that living relationship is lived out through his Son, Jesus. And we've got this great privilege, it's a real privilege, of having a share in that fellowship. Because God calls us to have a share in that fellowship. This is what we have as a right from God. This is what God gives to us. You, each one of you here, has a share in this fellowship that God has. It's a gift that God gives to each one of us. Fellowship isn't just something we go to or be a part of. It's a gift God gives to us. He says, I want you to know my koinonia. I want you to know fellowship with me. I want the church, whatever that church is, wherever that church meets, to have that fellowship. Because you have a share in this. You have a relationship with me. So often within our society, we forget this aspect of fellowship. We tend to see fellowship as something that we share with each other. But at the heart of koinonia, a fellowship is this relationship, this sharing with God. A God who transcends our reality. A God who is above all the things that we have, but is also within everything. Primarily, koinonia, fellowship, isn't something we simply choose to be a part of. is actually offered to us, given to us by God. We have fellowship not because we choose it, but because God chooses. We have a share. You have a share in this fellowship that God has to offer. And that should always make us feel so privileged and so welcome and so special, because this fellowship is way beyond and different to any of those other groups that we saw before. Why? Because at the heart is a God who just wants to give and give and give. You have a share. Next slide. And this koinonia, of course, is reflected in our worship and in our communion. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 16. The cup we use in the Lord's Supper, and for which we give thanks to God. When we drink from it, we are sharing in the blood of Christ. And the bread we break, when we eat it, we are sharing in the body of Christ. We are sharing Jesus. We are sharing in his body and his blood. We are sharing in his koinonia, this fellowship, which God gives to us. And of course, it was this common sharing of the body and blood of Christ that marked out that early Christian community. One of the things that stood out about the early Christians was the fact that they met together and they had this meal. And in this meal, they remembered Jesus dying. They remembered him saying, this is my body, this is my blood. And when they gave the bread out, they said these words and the wine. And it was an act that bound those early Christians together. For me, it's the most important of our services. It's the only one Jesus actually told us to do, to remember what he did. And he bound those Christians together. It made them distinctive. But also, it led to persecution. Because it meant that Christians, first of all, would not bow down to other gods. The Christians wouldn't pay their allegiance to Caesar. And also, in some parts, they were seen as cannibals, because people actually thought they were eating a body and the blood, drinking blood. There's a letter from Pliny the Younger talking about these cannibalistic acts of these early Christians. But communion marked out these people. This is my body, this is my blood. You have a share in it. You have a part in this. This is my gift to you. It's koinonia that you have in your possession, in your presence. And these new Christians also have another privilege as well. Ephesians 2. So Christ came and preached the good news of peace to all. To you Gentiles who were far away from God, and to the Jews who were near to him. It's through Christ that all of us, Jews and Gentiles, are able to come in one spirit into the presence of the Father. We'll never fully understand what it must have been like to be a Gentile within the Jewish community in the first century. We're told of the prejudice and the discrimination that they faced. But koinonia with God, through his son Jesus, opened the door to Gentiles to know salvation. But it wasn't just the Gentiles. Next one, please. In Colossians, Paul says, as a result, there is no longer any distinction between Gentiles and Jews, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarians, savages, slaves, free, Everton fans. But Christ... So they're right there. Just being carried away. But Christ is all, and Christ is in all. And this was the biggest change that this early church experienced. Because koinonia, fellowship with Jesus, given by God, broke down the social structures of that day. It broke down the divisions that were the foundation of life in the Roman Empire. And people knew their place in the Roman Empire. If you were a slave or free, if you were a Gentile or a Jew, if you were male or female, you knew your place. But here in this church, all those divisions were gone. And suddenly Jews and Gentile were together, rich and poor were together, slave and free were together in the same community. Men and women worshipped together, which was never heard of before. And so this koinonia was open to everybody. And there was no distinction. There was no you're in and you're out. And that challenges me, because I wonder who the equivalents are today. Who are the circumcised, the uncircumcised, the barbarians, the savages, the slaves, the free? Who are the people in our communities? And are they part of our fellowship and our koinonia? Are they with us? Those who don't fit in, those who don't belong. That's the amazing thing about God's fellowship. It is open to everybody. We are to be open to everybody. Nobody is out of reach when it comes to God's love. Even when we give up on people, even when we turn our backs, God never will. And that's the beauty, that's the wonder of this koinonia, this fellowship that God offers. So these new Christians prayed, they worshiped together, and this would have been such a challenge to many. And in particular those first Jewish Christians, because of course the church came out of the Jewish community. For many, actually, it was seen as a Jewish sect or just an offshoot of the Jewish faith. But for those Jewish Christians, it was a challenge because it meant including within their fellowship, within their koinonia, women and Gentiles, those who would have been excluded from parts of Jewish society and especially Jewish worship. And we are told that they even shared meals. And of course, again, this is probably, again, communion. This koinonia broke down barriers. It's a fellowship that allowed everybody to be a part. And the challenge always for our churches is our koinonia, is our fellowship one that breaks down barriers and allows everyone to be a part. Whoever we are, and however we are, there is a place for us. There's a share in this fellowship, this koinonia of Jesus, and it comes through God, his Father. And this gives us the idea of a community that's based on this love, this rooted on this foundation of God, with Jesus, our Lord, who is alive, who mediates for us, speaks to us, is with us always. Next slide, please. The koinonia that we give a share in, which is something to get our heads around. This community that started, this church community, this group of Christians, it was their whole life was based on sharing and having everything in common. Koinonia is about what we share in common. And here, it's a pragmatic act in the New Testament of being sure that nobody within the community ever went without. And again, it's within the community, within that group of Christians, nobody went without. All within that group would ensure that everybody else was cared for. Next slide, please. So koinonia is something we have a share in, but it's also something that people gave a share in. Later on in the book of Acts, chapter 4, we read this. The group of believers was in one mind and heart. None of them said that any of their belongings were their own. But they all shared with one another everything they had. Yeah, just keep going with that. There was no one in the group who was in need. Those who owned fields or houses would sell them, bring the money, receive from the sale, and turn it over to the apostles. And the money was distributed according to the needs of the people. Koinonia also refers to what we give to others, what we share with others. But again, it's within that community. It's within that community. And really, within any church community, there should be nobody who's without, nobody who is in need. Why? Because the rest of that community care for them. And again, that's such a challenge today within our communities, because we come, we meet, we disperse, and our fellowship may not be always maybe what God needs it to be. Next slide, please. Paul, in his second letter to the Corinthians, says this: I can assure you that they gave as much as they could, and even more than they could, of their own free will. It was a sharing which reached beyond the boundary of the local community into the wider church. Next slide, please. Paul said in Romans again, for the churches in Macedonia and Achaia have freely decided to give an offering to help the poor among God's people in Jerusalem. This fellowship that you share within your church, you are also part of a greater fellowship with the God's church throughout the world. And Paul was there talking about the way that these other churches, as poor as they were still giving to the church back in Jerusalem, because people there needed help. And again, it's a challenge to our society. How do we live? How are we in fellowship? How are we in Koinonia? There's a story, I was watching television once, the fascia. Have you watched the fascia? Okay. Which means this is good because nobody knows this. So, there's this youth and he's getting interviewed. And you can't see the interview, but he's sat down. And on his neck is a tattoo. And it's got the word independence. And the interviewer says to him, so what's that? He said, well, it's a tattoo, isn't it? He said, what does it say? It says independence. And why have you got that tattoo? Well, it says what I am, isn't it? And all my mates have got one as well. That's the world we live in, isn't it? You've got this urge all the time to be individual, be yourself, be number one, be the best, be the biggest, be the fastest, be the better preacher. In a society that's so concerned about individualism, at the same time, there's a sense that you want to belong. You want to be a part of something. And there's always that tension going on. Being independent, but being a part. And that comes into church. Because Koinonia says, actually, it's more than just coming on a Sunday. It's more than just worshipping together. As good as that is, it's how do you live together as the body of Christ? How do you live as this community? But at the same time, the world says, actually, you don't need to be a part of all that. You need to actually strive to be number one. You need to be yourself. You need to do things your way. Independence, but all my mates have it as well. Note that the giving that we read of in the Bible and the sharing was, again, within that Christian community. Those within the church, both locally and beyond. Koinonia, fellowship, means that there should be nobody goes without. Nobody who is in need. Do you know if that's the case at St. Anne's? Do you know if there is nobody in need? Something to think about. We've lost so much, really, of that sense of Koinonia. Because our society, we have welfare systems, we have insurance, we have charity, which are good things. So many ways in which people can be supported. And so when there is a need, well, there's always an organisation to meet that need. It can mean then that people within our churches do go unnoticed, feeling that they maybe can't call out for help here. Or sometimes they may feel even ashamed of being in such a situation. And every church has people like that. I remember when I was in theological college, a long time ago now, and a group of us ordinands, that's what we're called, visited an Assemblies of God church. Ever been to an Assemblies of God? Great. I mean, talk about worship, talk about that wonderful sense of being together and sharing. It was wonderful. And as usual during an Assemblies of God service, they normally call people to the front to tell everybody what God is doing in their lives and to give a testimony. And people were coming forward, they told about how God had got them a job, how they'd been healed, how they found a parking space. You know, those usual things. And so the congregation gave thanks to God and cheered each time, because God does good things. But it was after the service when we met a young woman who was in the congregation. She was quite distressed, and when we asked her why, she told us about her problems. She had no job, she had poor health, she had a young child to care for. And she said this to us, she said, I can't go to the front of the church and tell them that my life is really crap, because that's not what they want to hear. That's not what they want to know. Like you were saying, Towns, we have a good news slot. Ian challenged me the other week, you talked about God news, didn't you? And I think it's true, we'll talk about, have you got any good news? God news, that's what he said, didn't he? So have you got any God news? And people say, oh, have you got any good news? Well, yeah, I got a job last week. And we've got a new child in the family. And actually, I'm feeling so much better now. And we seem to separate God from what goes on in life. And it's almost as if what goes on in life, well, that's not really God's concern. We just got to get on and do with that. But unless, of course, it's good, and then that's good. But actually, God is there in every aspect of our lives, the good and the bad and the terrible. Sometimes people feel that because things are going so bad in their lives, obviously God must have a down around them. And maybe in this church, wherever this church may be, they don't want to hear that. They only hear good news. But that's not fellowship. That's not koinonia. People, however they are welcome. People, whoever they are, have a share. And you have that privilege of giving that share to the people around you, as well as sharing in the koinonia that God gives. Last bit I'm going to say for the moment, next please. The body. This isn't a reference to FaceTime. Yeah. Both these strands of sharing and giving, they come together in this phrase, the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians 12, which is a great chapter. Read the whole chapter. In the same way, though we are many, we are one body in union with Christ. And we are all joined together as different parts of the one body. And he develops that a bit further. The next one, please. But then he goes on to say, but the body itself is not made up of the one part, but of many parts. If a foot were to say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, that would not keep it from being part of the body. And again, please. Oh, that's a strange font, isn't it? And those parts that we think aren't worth very much are the ones which we treat with greater care, while the parts of the body which don't look very nice are treated with special modesty. We are the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. And all of us have a part. Remember Bishop James, you saw us have a phrase that the church should always be a battleship, not a cruise liner. The sad thing is most people just want a deck chair and enjoy the ride. But actually, I don't like the phrase in the sense that it's not all about work. It's about fellowship. It's about koinonia. It's about you coming together and enjoying each other's company with no strings attached. Enjoying the company of God through his son, Jesus Christ, and we'll look at that tomorrow. But also realizing that you, each and every one of you, have a wonderful part to play. You've got a wonderful privilege of being a member of a church, of the body of Christ. You all have a part, and whether you feel your part is more important than others or less important than others, it doesn't matter, because it's so vital. If you break your toe, you know about it, don't you? Because the whole body is affected. If you hurt your back, your whole body is affected. You know, every part of our body is important. If you lose a part of that, or if it's not treated well, everything suffers. And so koinonia comes together in this, you people here, the body of Christ. What you share with each other, what you give to each other, what you receive from each other. And it's more than just what happens on a Sunday. It's more than just what may happen midweek. It is your whole lives together. And if you can live within that fellowship and act within that fellowship, and somehow grasp that first century concept of fellowship, then your church is transformed. Why did that church grow so much? Because people looked at those first Christians and said, I want to be a part of that. I want to be, or have a share in that. I'm going to stop now because it's 5 minutes to coffee. Let me just say a prayer and then you can go. Lord God, help us as we continue this journey just to maybe unravel some of the things I've said. Maybe I've said too much, maybe I haven't said enough. But help us to think about this koinonia, the share that you give us in your fellowship, the opportunities you give us to give to that fellowship. Hold us special in your hearts now, and especially those who are on our hearts and minds as a result of this morning. And I pray this all in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen.